Hey, this is Zach with the Deerfield Public Library Makerspace, and today I'm bringing you a super fun and not too difficult project using our laser engraver. We're going to be taking a plain piece of 4-inch by 4-inch plywood and turning it into a totally unique and customized name tag. This, of course, can be used for far more than a name tag, such as a sign for your door, something to adorn your cabinets, or just use as a fun necklace. There's quite a range of different styles you can achieve for this, and it really all depends on the font you're using for your lettering. What's a font? A font is simply a set of characters, symbols, and letters with a consistent style and appearance. In simpler terms, think of a font as a particular look or design for the letters and numbers you see on your computer screen or on a printed piece of paper. You may even recognize some different font names, as many operating systems such as Windows and Mac OS have libraries of default fonts that have become rather well known throughout the years. With all this being said, there are thousands upon thousands of custom fonts that you can download online from websites such as DeFont or 1001 Fonts. You're free to look for a font on these websites that better suits your taste, but for today's purposes, I'm just going to use a pre-installed font that already exists on the computer. So let's get started and hop on over to the computer. Our first step will be to open Inkscape, which we can do by double-clicking the Inkscape icon on our desktop. This will open up a welcome dialog, and we can just go and click the New Document button to open up a new instance of Inkscape. When our Inkscape document opens, we're going to go and change the page size to match that of our wood square so that each part of our design is guaranteed to be the correct size and fit within the wood we're cutting into. We can do this by going to the File menu at the top left, scrolling down to the Document Properties option, and clicking on it. This will open up a separate window where we can adjust a wide range of features regarding the Inkscape document and interface. But the only fields that we need to worry about right now are these two labeled width and height. Make sure that you're currently sizing your page in inches by checking this small drop-down menu to the right of where it says Format. If we're not in inches, our page won't be the correct size and we'll have issues when moving over to cut our wood on the laser. And while we're at it, let's also change the display units to the right of the page size and set those to inches as well. This will save us some time when changing other drop-down menus later on in the video. So we're going to go ahead and set both our width and height to be 4 inches, then just go and close out of the document properties by pressing the X in the top right corner of the window. Go ahead and press 5 to recenter the page to fill the screen. Our page is now a perfect square and we can start designing the elements of our name tag. We're going to go and select the text tool that can be found over here to the left of the screen, which looks like a big A with a line next to it. When we click that, we can then go and click anywhere in the page, and a new text field will appear, which will allow us to start typing out our wording, which in my case will just be my name. I'm going to go and type out Zach, then go back to our tools on the left of the screen and choose the icon that looks like a simple mouse cursor. This will take us back to the tool which allows us to simply move objects around and resize them. You may have noticed that your text is currently rather small, which is no problem at all, as we can resize the text to be just as big as we want. You may or may not be familiar with the term vector if you watched our video on the topic, but a vector is simply an infinitely scalable type of image, meaning no matter how big or small we make it, the visual quality will never decrease. And luckily for us, fonts are vectors. We have a couple of ways of resizing our text, the first of which is simply by dragging these arrows on the corner of the dotted box surrounding our letters. Make sure you're holding the Control button on PC or the Command button on Mac to ensure that our text remains proportional when being scaled, or else it will end up looking stretched out and generally not very appealing. Our other option of resizing the text is by adjusting the width and height fields at the top of the screen, each noted by the W and the H to the left of the input field. And if you look in between the width and height fields, you'll also see a padlock icon. We want to click that so it appears to be in the locked position. All this does is ensure that when we change either the width or height, the other will also be adjusted simultaneously to keep our text proportional, similarly to how we hold the Control button when scaling with the arrows. Since we need to have some pretty precise measurements for this project, we're going to use the width and height fields to resize, rather than the transformation arrows that surround our text object. With your text selected, go and set the width field, noted as W, to 3.5, which will set the text to be 3.5 inches wide. It will also adjust the height so that our text doesn't distort. Now, just grab the text and move it so that it is just about centered to the page. Excellent. Now with our text size correctly, we can go ahead and move on to creating the background piece of our name tag, which will be achieved by using the tool which looks like a paint bucket with a drop coming out of it. In Inkscape, this is called the Fill Bounded Areas tool and can be extremely useful for creating outlines that are in the same shape as our current object, but which extend slightly outwards from the main design. We can use this to make the backing part of the tag, which the main letters will be glued onto. So go ahead and select the Fill Bounded Areas tool, and then change the Grow Shrink By value at the top of the screen to be 15 inches. Go ahead and click directly on the first letter of your name you typed out, which will create a big, blobby version of that letter. Currently though, it's a solid black color, which we don't want. Let's go up to the Object menu at the top of the screen, and scroll down to the second option called Fill and Stroke, and click it. This will open up the window that allows us to change everything from the color inside the object, the color of the outline, to the width of the outline. What we need specifically, though, is to completely remove the fill color. We can achieve that by clicking the small X symbol seen here to the left of the small square that is currently selected. The one selected indicates a solid fill color, and by clicking the X, we've removed any color whatsoever and made the object transparent. You may have noticed that it disappeared, but don't worry, it's still there. Now we need to click over to the Stroke Paint tab, where we're going to enable a stroke for this new object. Click the solid square to the next of the X, essentially the reverse of what we did for the fill color. You should suddenly see the object once again become visible, only this time it's an outline rather than a solid color. Go ahead and click directly on the rest of your letters, which will create bounded shapes for the rest of them. If everything was done correctly, we should have a bunch of overlapping outlines surrounding our name we typed out. We only have a couple steps left before we're ready to send this to the laser. What we're going to need to do now is return to the Select and Transform tool, which again can be found to the left of the screen and looks like a simple mouse cursor. Afterwards, we're going to want to select all of our outline objects together. We can do this by first clicking on the first of the outlines, then holding down the Shift button and clicking on the rest of them. Make sure you're clicking on the actual outline and not the inner text object. With all of the outlines selected, we now need to combine them into one single outline. We can do this by navigating up to the Path menu at the top of the screen and selecting the Union option. This is telling Inkscape to take all of our selected outlines and remove all of the overlap between them so that it becomes one single continuous shape. With this done, let's now go and remove the fill and set the stroke for our inner text, which would be disabling the fill color and giving it a stroke color. We now have both our inner and outer shapes as just outlines, which is needed to tell the laser to trace these shapes, rather than engrave them. Select the outer shape, and while in the stroke color panel, drag the top red slider all the way to the right. You'll also want to make sure that you're currently in RGB mode, which can be checked by looking at the dropdown here to the right of the color sliders. This ensures that the color of our outer shape's outline is pure red, which is just another factor in telling the laser we want these shapes cut out. Now select the inner text and set these outlines to blue, which can be done by dragging the red slider all the way back to the left and the bottom blue one all the way to the right. Now go up to the edit menu and select the duplicate option, which will make a copy of the inner text. Click and drag the text downwards while holding Control on PC or Command on Mac to keep it moving in just one direction. Set this duplicated text to once again have a stroke color of red. Select all of the shapes by clicking and dragging the selection box over everything. Move them back so that they all fit within the square page we set up. Now we just have one final step before we're ready to laser cut. With all of our shapes still selected, we'll want to select the Stroke Style tab next to Stroke Color and set the stroke width of all of our shapes to be exactly 0.01 millimeters. This is what we call a hair line, and it is the final piece of the puzzle in telling the laser we want it to trace these shapes, not engrave them. After that has been done, we're officially done designing. Go ahead and save the file by navigating to the File tab and selecting Save As. This will open up a new Explorer window where we can select where our file is being saved. Set your save type to be PDF, give it a unique name, and save it. Go ahead and give yourself a pat on the back. You made it through the hardest part of this project. All we have to do now is open this PDF inside Adobe Acrobat and send it to the laser engraver. We can do this by going to File, Print, and adjusting our laser settings by choosing the Preferences option, which while normally leading to your standard printer settings, will in our case open up the laser's material library, where we can select what type of material we'll be using. I'm going to select General Medium Wood from the Natural dropdown and make sure the thickness is correct. Apply these settings and hit OK, which will take us back to the print dialog. Go ahead and hit Print to send it to the laser. Once we've focused the laser and aligned our design to fit exactly onto our piece of wood, we're finally ready to once and for all get cutting. Let's watch the laser in action. Okay, now with the laser finished cutting, you can see we have a couple different items. First, we have the backing with the shapes of our letter etched into it. The reason we set the inner letters to blue was so that the laser only scores the surface of the wood, and we can now use these trace shapes as a guide to glue on our cutout letters in a very precise manner. But first off, let's paint. I'm just going to put a couple coats of this metallic paint on our cutout letters and the backing so that when we glue them together, they'll have this nice, contrasty, shiny look to them. Alright, with our pieces all fancy and colorful, let's go ahead and drop some small dots of plain white glue along each of our scored letters. We're going to place the cut ones onto the backing and adjust them so that they fit perfectly inside the scored lines. After that, we super glue our button component onto the backing. Congratulations! You now have a beautiful and completely custom name tag and learned some different ways to use Inkscape in the process. Thanks again for tuning in, and we'll see you in the next video. This is X, signing off.